اللہ تعالیٰ کو حاضر ناظر جان کر کہتا ہوں کہ میں خلافت احمدیہ پر ایمان رکھتا ہوں اور میں خلافت احمدیہ کو قیامت تک جاری رکھنے کے لیے پوری کوشش کروں گا اور اسلام کی تبلیغ کو دنیا کے کناروں تک پہنچانے کے لیے انتہائی کوشش کرتا رہوں گا.
These were the words of Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad as he took an oath that would forever transform his life. He was no longer as other men. He was a man of God. It was the 18th day of December in the year 1928. The day brought news of the first ever train from Amritsar. The mood among the locals of Qadian was festive. Many of the elders of the town had gone to Amritsar to board the train and experience the historic journey. The commencement of the train service would usher a new era for the movement, as more people could now visit Qadian. This town was once home to Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, who claimed to be the promised Messiah. His son and the second successor of his movement, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad, was now leading his cause. The day also brought further good news for Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad and his wife, Hazrat Maryam Siddiqa. It was the birth of their son, Tahir. His mother took every precaution to ensure his good health and upbringing. He grew up as a happy child, ready to play and take any challenge thrown at him. Being the son of the Khalifa, and also the only son of Hazrat Maryam Siddiqa, he occupied a privileged position, but he was never overprotected or spoiled. His mother wanted him to be a doctor or physician, but he was never interested in pursuing such a career.
अब्बा मुझे याद है ये कहा करते थे कि मेरी वालदा की बड़ी ख्वाहिश थी कि डॉक्टर बने मेरा बेटा और गुरबा का मुफत इलाज करे.
As a humble child, I started my life in the ordinary schools of Qadian. I was never a very brilliant student, but always I was interested in human affairs, in social works and so on and so forth. So I managed to scrape through in my school education.
At the young age of 16, he had to bear a poignant loss.
His mother died in 1944 when he was appearing in his matriculation examination. During that period, his mother died.
Despite his grief at this difficult time in his life, he continued with his studies. He developed an interest not only in classical Urdu writers, but also Shakespeare, Charles Dickens, Conan Doyle, and other English writers. He started writing poetry. He also developed a deep interest in the study of the Holy Quran and started to memorize it, but soon realized that he was more interested in the meaning of the words. He took studying the Quran intently. He discovered his father's library and started reading books on Darwin's theory of evolution. Although he never had doubts about Islam or the existence of God, he started investigating the possibility of the existence of God on a logical basis.
I have myself researched into this issue because right from my childhood it has been bothering me in so many ways. And because the religion I believe in is a religion of which I am completely convinced. Those parts of which I was not convinced, I have been praying about them and also making my own investigations. So that today as I stand, I can say honestly that I believe in everything which I claim I believe in, through conviction, not through dogmatism.
In his biography, he stated that one afternoon, he went through an experience which resolved for him forever the question of the existence of God. The experience, he said, could not be looked upon objectively as a potent proof of the existence of God, but he had no doubt that it was God's answer. I was in a state of semi-consciousness, halfway between a dream and reality. I saw the entire earth squeezed into a ball. There was no creation of any sort visible, no life, no cities, nothing, just the earth. Then I saw each particle of the world tremble and burst out into a slogan, Ah, God. Each particle was proclaiming the reason for its existence. The whole world was flooded with a strange light, and every atom of the earth began to swell and contract in rhythm. I found myself repeating the words, Our God. As he returned to full consciousness, he could still see it happening. Although he never had any doubts, this experience affirmed his faith in an unshakable belief in God's existence. The political situation of the subcontinent of India in the 1940s became very fragile. The British monarchy had decided that the subcontinent should be divided into two separate nations, one for Hindus and one for Muslims, and be given independence. Muslims and Hindus had lived for years as neighbors, but at the height of the unrest, without rationale, suddenly hated each other. No one was safe. Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad was now a strong young man and part of the Ahmadiyya youth movement, Hudamul Ahmadiyya. He was among many from Hudamul Ahmadiyya who formed into companies and battalions for the defense of Qadian. He was appointed as the officer in charge of one of these units. His task was to organize the defense of the center of Qadian. In August 1947, the community faced an unexpected crisis. The entire area had fallen inside the territory allocated to India. His father, the head of the community, ordered the evacuation of Qadian.
At that time, my late father was sent a message by late Mahatma Gandhi, exactly pointing out to him the so-called mistake he was about to commit. My father, then in a sermon, he told Ahmadis in very clear terms what was in store for them. He said, we are opting for Pakistan, yet I assure you that in Pakistan you will be dealt with so cruelly and you will be deprived of all your rights ultimately that if I tell you now you will shudder and the weak among you may have heart failures. But there is no option. Because once we accept, we opt out of the Muslim Ummah, for us physically and politically, it may seem to be an easier, more acceptable cause. But to the message of Ahmadiyyat, that will be a deadly poison. So whatever decision was taken with full knowledge of what was to happen.
Leaving 313 Ahmadis behind to look after the property of the community until they could return, the members of the community migrated. In Pakistan, the community established a new center on a 1,034-acre site near the west bank of the river Chenab. It was called Rabwa. All the sons of Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad had been dedicated to the service of the community, including Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad. He started working in the youth movement, Hudamul Ahmadiyya, and proved to be a good administrator and an exceptionally hard worker.
When he became a khadim, he became a saik and then proceeded through the various responsibilities within the organization of Majlis-e-Qadam-e Ahmadiyya, culminating in being a naib sadr and ultimately sadr Majlis-e-Qadam-e Ahmadiyya. At that time, it was for the whole world. And he served in that position for many years.
Along with the service to the community, he continued his secular studies at Government College Lahore.
The Government College Lahore, a very reputable institution in the north of India, particularly in the Punjab. And there I studied for 4 years. I went originally for BSc, Bachelor of Science, but ended up by getting an honorary degree, in bachelor's degree. And again, I studied in an Ahmadiyya institution and did my doctorate on comparative religion, particularly in the study of Islam.
By 1954, Rabwa was a town of 45,000 people. In the center of the town, gleaming in white brilliance, stood the elegant Mubarak Mosque.
In March 1954, a young boy, about 19 years of age, he attacked Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Sani when he finished his leading his Asr prayer in Masjid Mubarak, and he stabbed him on his neck, and the knife entered, the blade entered deep in the body.
Though the wound itself was to heal rapidly, it had a serious effect on his nervous system. His health deteriorated, and he was unable to work his usual long hours. Some 2 years later, he went to seek advice from specialists in London.
Quite a few members of Huzoor's family accompanied him. Among Huzoor's children was Hazrat Mirza Munawar Ahmad Sahib, Dr. Mirza Munawar Ahmad Sahib, Mirza Mubarak Ahmad Sahib, then Mirza Tahir Ahmad Sahib.
After the treatment, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II decided to return to Ravva, but he left Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad, now aged 26, behind in London. Although according to the original plans, he was due to return with his father, but his father had other plans for him. In London, he lived in Maida Vale and studied at the University of London. Although he had learnt English at school, it was at the London University where he learned how to express himself better in the language. Whilst in London, he also had the opportunity to travel in Europe and meet a range of people. About his experience in London, he states in his biography, "At the School of Oriental Studies, I had met people from all over the world, from Africa, from Germany and Poland, from all parts of Europe, really, and from America and Canada and South America. I believe that was important, that God had decided that was what I should do, even though I did not know it at the time. He had decided that I should meet all these people and that I should go out and travel in Europe. I think that was his design." He returned to Ravva in October 1957 and got married in December that year to Hazrat Sayyida Asifa Begum. That very same year, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II appointed him at the office of Waqf-e Jadid, which looked after the needs of Ahmadis living in rural communities in East and West Pakistan. His new post in the Waqf-e Jadid put him in direct contact with the small farmers, villagers and shopkeepers, who were one of the great strengths of the community. He was always very caring for the poor and the needy, and this was also apparent in his personal life.
और बाकी के लिए तो बाकी मुझे बहुत वजह से मैं देखती थी कि बहुत ज़्यादा अब्बा मैं तड़पती क्योंकि मतलब हम लोग तभी छोटे थे तो मुझे याद है जब हम लोग कभी जमीना बाज़ार पे बच्चियाँ जा रही हैं तो उम्मी का कहा उम्मी हमें पैसे दे मैंने मीना बाज़ार हमारे स्कूल का तो उम्मी के ने अभी दिए नहीं थे या कम दे रही थी जो भी था तो अब्बा ने सुन लिया अब्बा कहते कि मैं देता हूँ तो 10-10 रुपये दिए थे उसके 10 रुपये बहुत ज़्यादा लगते थे तो क्या था लेकिन एक शर्त है कि तुम लोगों ने साथ अपने साथ किसी गरीब बच्चों का भी साथ कुछ खराब फलाओगी और ये करोगी तो शुरू से इतना मतलब ये था कि हर चीज़ में तुम लोगों ने उनका हिस्सा रखना है और मोहब्बत करनी है उनसे और इसी तरह अब्बा घर में मुलाजमी इनके साथ भी बहुत ज़्यादा हंसने सलूक से रखते रहते थे कि यहाँ तक कि एक दफ़ा मुझे याद है उम्मी को कह रहे थे कि लोगों को तो मुलाजमी रखने की मुसीबत होती है कि आते नहीं हैं हमें निकालने की मुश्किल पड़ जाती है जाते नहीं हैं इतने अच्छी तरह रखते थे कि वो जाने पर भी नाराज़ी होते थे
special bond between him and people. I don't understand how and why, but it was a special bond. Whoever used to be with him once, he used to get hooked to him.
Wherever he worked very hard. And he always worked and showed his example, but he used to work in the land as he is a peasant, so to show them that he can do whatever he asks them to do, he can do himself also. So he was a great leader and very active and eloquent, and he was a good speaker. He could speak for hours on different topics. Later he started question answer also with non-Ahmadis.
हज़रत खलीफा सालिस भी जब लोग आया करते थे गैर जमात मौलवी वगैरह भी आते थे تو حضرت خلیفہ ثالث زیادہ تر ابا کے کوئی کہتے تھے کہ آپ ان سے مجلس کریں گے.
He led a very disciplined life, serving the cause of the community. He used to start his day very early in the morning and was at his office well before anyone else.
ابا کا ایک تو میں آپ کو بتاؤں کہ یہ تو ایک طریقہ تھا نا, صبح نماز کے بعد تہجد اور نماز کے بعد ابا تلاوت کرتے تھے. یہ تو مجھے جب سے میں نے ہوش سنبھالا یہ میں نے دیکھا. اس کے بعد پھر ابا تھوڑی دیر کے لیے سوتے ضرور تھے, پھر ابا چلے جاتے تھے اپنے وقف جدید کے رفتار. تو دوپہر کو آتے تھے ڈھائی تین ساڑھے تین کے درمیان, اور اس وقت ان کے ملازمین بھی اپنے کواٹروں میں جا چکے ہوتے تھے. کبھی ابا نے کسی کو نہیں کہا کہ مجھے کھانا نکال کے دو یا گرم کر کے دو. کھانا پڑا ہوتا تھا اور خود ہی نکال کے بیٹھ جاتے تھے. ہم لوگ تو بچے تھے تو مجھے یاد ہے کہ اوپر کے سب میزوں پہ بھی چڑھ کے بیٹھ جاتے تھے, ابا کے ساتھ باتیں بے تکلفی بات تھی, تو اس لیے ساری باتیں کرتے رہتے تھے سوال جواب. اور ابا بڑی خوشی خوشی سے ہر بات کا جواب بھی دے رہے ہیں اور ساتھ ساتھ کھانا بھی کھا رہے ہیں. اتنا محبت کا سلوک بندہ ہوا تھا کہ ابا کی ناراضگی سب سے بڑی سزا لگتی تھی. اس لیے یہ ہوتا تھا کہ اگر جہاں یہ دیکھتے تھے کہ ابا کو کسی بات سے تکلیف ہو رہی ہے تو ہمارے لیے سخت تکلیف تھے اور شرم والی بات بن جاتی تھی. تربیت کا مجھے جو سب سے ابا کا انداز اچھا لگا کہ بچوں سے یا کسی سے بھی ایسی محبت کا سلوک باندھ لیتے تھے کہ اس کی وجہ سے انسان بہت سی باتوں سے بچ جاتا ہے.
It is one of the ironies of history that the Ahmadiyya movement, which was instrumental in the creation of Pakistan, was persecuted by the so-called religious scholars or ulema, who had been so violently opposed to its creation. The persecution was politically inspired to divert the attention of the population from real problems that the country was facing. 1953 saw some of the worst rioting against Ahmadi Muslims and the community.
There was a generalized riot in the Punjab. It was supported by the Punjab government, quietly, not officially. So it became out of control, went out of control, and ultimately the first martial law was imposed because of this.
This wave of persecution continued for nearly 20 years, both at institutional and grassroots level.
What you observe today in Pakistan is not just a public wrath turned against Ahmadis. It is the government legal persecution.
In 1965, Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi II passed away. Hazrat Mirza Nasir Ahmad, the son of Khalifa Tulmasi II and the elder brother of Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad, was chosen as the third Khalifa. The problems for the community continued in Pakistan. Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad worked under the guidance of the third Khalifa to deal with the problems the community was facing. In 1974, legislation was proposed in the National Assembly of Pakistan declaring that Ahmadis were not Muslims. Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi III led a five-man delegation to the National Assembly, which discussed the proposed legislation. Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad was the youngest member of the delegation, a compliment to his knowledge, sagacity, and familiarity with the history and traditions of the community. In 1974, Pakistan's National Assembly declared that Ahmadis were not Muslims.
In 1974, Bhutto committed the mistake of interfering with a religious process for which he was not politically entitled. You see?
Yeah.
And that opened the Pandora's box. After that, nobody could be able to close it.
Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad continued to serve the community with great zeal. From 1979 to 1982, he served as the president of Majlis-e-Ansarullah. He also served as director of Fazl-e-Umma Foundation and patron of the International Ahmadiyya Association of Architects and Engineers. His life took a dramatic turn in 1982. On the 8th of June that year, his brother and the head of the community, Hazrat Mirza Nasir Ahmad, Khalifa Tulmasi III, passed away just before midnight.
वो रात, वो रात बेपनाह थी और मैं गरीब था.
Nearly 100,000 members gathered at the headquarters in Rabwa. In accordance with the constitution of the community's electoral college, a meeting of the college was convened at the Mubarak Mosque in Rabwa to elect the new Khalifa. Under divine guidance, the electoral college elected Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad as the fourth Khalifa. Overwhelmed with emotion, he first took the oath and then the covenant of allegiance. Right from the outset of his Khilafat, he served the destitute and the weak. The very first project he launched was the construction of suitable houses for the needy people in Rabwa. A neighborhood in the city was established under this scheme. It was called Buyut ul Hamd. Only 1.5 months after becoming Khalifa, Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad, Khalifa Tulmisi IV, travelled to Norway, Sweden, Denmark, Switzerland, Holland, Spain, the UK and Australia. He inaugurated the Basharat Mosque in Pedroabad, a town 25 kilometres outside Cordoba. This was the first mosque to be built in Spain in over 750 years.
सबसे पहले इस मौके पर मुझे एक याद सता रही है. उस वजूद की याद जो आज हम में नहीं, जो सबसे ज्यादा इस बात का हकदार था. आज ये जुमा पढ़ाता और आज इस तकरीब का आगाज करता कि वो बेकरार दुआएं जिनकी कबूलियत का फल हम आज खाने लगे.
He addressed several press conferences, wherein he provided erudite interpretation of Islamic teachings. The newly elected Khalifa was on a peaceful mission, a mission to serve humanity. But the political situation in Pakistan became worse than ever before.
The moment I was selected by Allah to lead the Jamaat, Zia did not like this perspective at all.
The regime of Zia wanted some political philosophy to support their regime politically and to give them a reason, a justification for remaining in power. So what they said was, they said they are the custodians of Islam. As such, they have to serve certain purposes for the sake of Islam. And as long as those purposes are not served and achieved, they would remain in power. You know, as if they were commissioned by God to do that. So for this, they had to align and implicate mullahs and to utilize and exploit them. And what was the purpose for which they were destined to play a very important role, you know? The purpose was to destroy the foremost enemy of Islam, that is Ahmadiyya community.
It was during Zia's time the persecution against the Ahmadiyya community peaked. Their shops were pillaged and set on fire, and mobs rioted outside their mosques. The discrimination practiced by the Bhutto government was stepped up.
Tum musibatein hum par isliye dal rahe ho ki hum apne khuda se dur hat jaye, lekin tumhari ayat karda musibatein hame aur zyada khuda ke kareeb kar deti. हम अपने रब की तरफ और तेजी के साथ लौट जाते हैं.
Hazrat Khalifa Tulmisi IV urged restraint on his followers. Do not respond to these provocations. He denounced in sermon after sermon the injustices that Zia was inflicting. God would punish him if he continued in his evil ways. God's wrath would be terrible. Hazrat Khalifa Tulmisi warned him again and again, but the general paid no attention to the warnings and continue to plot schemes in order to destroy the community.
You know, when I suspected that something is cooking against Ahmadiyya between the mullahs and the then dictator of Pakistan, Zia-ul Haq, instead of running away, I went straight to Islamabad and camped there
for 7 days.
He had many friends among the diplomatic community. Some he met at their offices, and some privately. From the meetings, he gathered something was going to happen, but no one seemed to know exactly what.
Until the deputy commissioner of Islamabad sent me a very urgent message. This deputy commissioner said, my earnest advice to you is, for God's sake, return immediately to Ramallah, or it will be too late.
Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi IV immediately returned to Ramallah. On the 26th of April 1984, Ordinance 20 was introduced under martial law by General Ziaul-Haq. The ordinance was designed to prohibit Ahmadis from practicing their faith.
I immediately called a meeting of all the Ahmadi elders, whoever were available at the time, to reach Rabwa immediately. I stated before them the facts, the consequences of this ordinance. I told them that according to this ordinance, if I remain in Pakistan and declare myself to be a Muslim, immediately they would arrest me and put me behind the bar. So how can I remain a Khalifa of Jamaatul Ahmadiyya, Khalifatul Masih, and operative at the same time?
The advice at the meeting was unanimous. Huzoor should leave Pakistan immediately. At that time, Usman Chu, a missionary of the community who had no idea of what was being planned, saw a dream.
Maine 27 April 1986 ki subah ka waqt tha. Main ye dikha ke Huzoor Islamabad jaane wale hain. और एक मिनी पास में जाएंगे जिसके इर्द गिर्द हुजूर के पहरेदार मौजूद हैं और जो सब के सब आसमानी रंग की यूनिफॉर्म पहनती हैं और इन पहरेदारों के इर्द गिर्द सरकारी पुलिस हैं जब मैं इस पास के करीब आ गया जब मैं इस पास के करीब गया तो मैंने हुजूर को नहीं दिखा और ये समझा कि हुजूर तो ऐब की तरीक इस्लामाबाद तशरीफ ले गए हैं और पास के अंदर तो सिर्फ कुछ समय मौजूद हैं फिर मैंने उसी पास में हुजूर की अलविदा कहने के लिए बैठ गया और पहरेदारों के साथ सफ़र करने लगा कुछ सफ़र करके उधर किया और पहरेदारों ने मुझे कुछ फाल दिया इस ख्वाब से मैं समझता हूँ चंद बातें जो मैंने खुद खिदमत में पेश भी की थी नंबर वन ये है कि अल्लाह ताला جماعت حضور حفاظت فرمائے گا نمبر دو حضور سب کے سب انعام بھی فرمائے گا اور سب کے سب نہایت زیادہ ترقی بھی دیں گے انشاءاللہ تعالی
انبلیویبل نو دیٹ ری اشورڈ می آئی نیو دین With the grace of Allah, it's Allah's hand, he already has told us and forewarned us.
It was decided that Huzoor would leave Pakistan by KLM. And a messenger was sent to Karachi to do the booking instead of booking by telephone, and that could be tapped.
It was decided that I would leave on Sunday morning by car. And then we reached at about 10:30. Reached Karachi. And after eating food and just a little rest, we left for the airport because the plane, I remember, left at 12:30. Now, they told me to come late. Said, there's no need for you to come early. They said exactly 5 minutes from the time of the departure of the plane, we will send our special car.
Everything seemed to be all right, and the manager assured that the flight would leave in time.
And the car came exactly 5 minutes before 12:30. And it was sent back.
The airport authorities, they stopped the flight from going on the scheduled time.
The order that I said of the Ahmadiyya community is not permitted to leave the country from any borders was signed by Zia himself. Ziaul Haq lived most of his time during the time of Hazrat Khalifa al-Masih Salis, the third caliph. So what he dictated was, and this is written prohibition letter, that Mirza Nasir Ahmed, the fourth head of the Ahmadiyya community, before that, is not permitted to leave the country from any borders. They had a dilemma. They could not stop Mirza Tahir Ahmed from going on. And they did not know much intricacies about the fourth and third caliphate, you know. So they must have started ringing the intelligence chief of the intelligence bureau in Islamabad and trying to get clearance from him or instructions that this is the case. That is why this was delayed. So at 1:30, we left. The plane, of course, went to Geneva and from there on to Holland, and there we had to wait for a while, then we came to London.
Around midday, Huzoor arrived at Heathrow Airport, and by the grace of Allah, we had made all the arrangements, no problem, no difficulty, and the staff of the KLM, the airline on which Huzoor travelled, they were also available to receive Huzoor.
Once in London, Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi could carry on his duties as the Khalifa. He, however, had to establish London as the new headquarters of the community.
He had a knack of making everybody feel extremely special. You know, whatever he wanted someone to do, he made them feel that they were capable of doing whatever that was.
He would find out what type of worker is he, and he would accordingly allot him the tasks. He was very clear in his mind. He wanted the job to be done to the exact manner what he wanted to. And when that work is done, then he will, you know, praise him like anything.
Aur hausla afzai ki to intaha thi. Chota sa kisi ne kaam kiya, to us pe is tarah daad dete the ki aadmi sharminda hota tha ki ye to maine to kuch bhi nahi kiya. اور اس کے نتیجے میں پھر انسان کو ایک اور طاقت ملتی تھی. میں سمجھتا ہوں کہ اصل میں خلیفۃ المسیح کی دعا اور روحانی توجہ اور حوصلہ افزائی کے نتیجے میں ایک طاقت ملتی تھی, اور وہ جو اس نے چھوٹا سا کام کیا وہ اسے کئی گنا کر جاتا تھا اگلی دفعہ. اس پہ جب حوصلہ افزائی میں اسے ملتی تھی اور دعا اور توجہ اور شفقت, تو اس سے پھر اور آگے بڑھتا تھا.
اینڈ آئی تھنک پیپل جسٹ کڈنٹ ڈو انف, دے ور ٹرائنگ دیئر بیسٹ ٹو fulfill whatever was the need of the moment.
Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad was a visionary. He foresaw the progress of the community and the need for workers in every sphere of life in the coming decades.
You know, this Waqf-e-Nau scheme, he started on 3rd April 1987, and I'm surprised because in 1984 he left Pakistan in very difficult conditions. You know, there was law against us, so he had to leave Pakistan. But within 3 years, he realized that Jamaat is now going to expand in much bigger scope. So for that, he instructed Jamaat's parents that they should offer their children even before the birth, and then train them accordingly so they become good waqfin zindagi.
Har mulk se jab waqf honge bacche, تو اس ملک کی زبان کو بھی سمجھتے ہوں گے, اس ملک مزاج کو بھی سمجھتے ہوں گے. جب اس ملک میں یہ بچے وقت کر کے بڑے ہوں گے اور کام کرنا شروع کریں گے, تو یہ بہت اچھا کام کر سکتے ہیں. और ये बजाय इसके कि एक जगह से वक्फ होकर निकलें, ये सारी दुनिया में तंजीम की तौर पर इस तरह फैल जाए।
Once the new setup in London was established, Hazrat Khalifa Tulmisi IV was able to lead the community freely. However, back in Pakistan, Zia's persecution continued. Huzoor's warnings grew stronger and stronger. Night after night, month after month, he prayed to God for help for his beleaguered people. He warned Zia in his sermon on the 3rd of June 1988.
Aur Pakistan ke badnaseeb sarbarah ne jo pehle dictator ke taur par zahir hue phir uske baad sadr ka chola pehna wo is waqt Hazrat Masih Maud Alaihi Salam ki takzeeb ke sabse bade lambardar hai aur unke tamam manne walon ko bhi और उनको भी जो तकलीब में पेश पेश हैं और हुकूमत पाकिस्तान से ताल्लुक़ रखते हैं और उनको भी जो तकलीब में पेश पेश हैं और उलमा के तबके से ताल्लुक़ रखते हैं उनको भी जो तकलीब में पेश पेश हैं और अदलिया से ताल्लुक़ रखते हैं उनको भी जो तकलीब में पेश पेश हैं और सियासत से ताल्लुक़ रखते हैं उनको भी जो तकलीब में पेश पेश हैं और आवाम से ताल्लुक़ रखते हैं लेकिन कुछ ग्रोहों के सरबराह हैं उन सब को मैं मुखातब करके तमाम जमात अहमदिया की तरफ से मुबाहले का चैलेंज देता हूँ अगर तुम मुबाहले के लिए तैयार हो तो मैं जमात अहमदिया की सरबराही में ऐलान करता हूँ कि लानतुल्लाह अल काज़िबीन तुम भी अपने चेलों चांटों को इकट्ठा करो अपने बड़ों और छोटों को बुलाओ अपनी औरतों और बच्चों को बुलाओ और ये ऐलान जमात अहमदिया के मद्दे मुकाबले करने के लिए
The challenge of Mubaila had been issued, but despite the warnings, Zia did not mend his ways.
हुकूमत का जहां तक ताल्लुक है वो मासूम अहमदियों पर कानूनी हरबे इस्तेमाल करके तरह तरह के सितम ढा रही है और आपको याद होगा कि मैंने आगाज ही में हुकूमत को ये मुतनब्बे किया था कि आप अगर अपनी शान के खिलाफ भी समझते हों चैलेंज को कबूल करना अगर आप ज्यादतियों से बाज ना आए और जुल्म सितम की ये राह ना छोड़ी तो जहाँ तक मैं समझता हूँ खुदा की तकदीर इसे मुबाहले के चैलेंज कबूल करने के मुतरादिफ बनाएगी और आप सजा से बच नहीं सकेंगे
हजरत खलीफा तुलमिसी IV saw a dream which contained a message from God.
I saw in a dream that I was translating a portion of Hazrat Masih Maud, the founder of the Ahmadiyya community's writings. The history repeats itself, but not the way you think it repeats. It repeats itself in a different way. And when I said this, there were some Englishmen sitting around me, and they said that you are not making the correct translation. The history repeats itself, as we understand, is a different concept. But there are certain things which in essence always repeat, and nobody can change the course of this history. Those who clash with God or his messengers, they are always destroyed. That is how history repeats itself, not like you understand. And in the morning, when I got up, then I knew it was a message about Zia.
On Friday, the 12th of August, under divine guidance, Hazrat Khalifa Tulmisi IV declared there was no way back for Zia.
इसका मतलब ये है कि जिस कौम को हम मुखातब कर रहे हैं आज, जिसको हमने मुबाहले की दावत दी है, बदकिस्मती से उनके मुकद्दर में खुदा ताला की नाराजगी का दिन देखना है। वरना अल्लाह ताला इस रंग में मुझे ये पैगाम ना देता कि हिस्ट्री रिपीट्स इटसेल्फ उसमें कोई तब्दीली नहीं देखोगे मुजरिमों को खुदा जरूर सजा देगा जमात अहमदिया तो खुदा ताला के फजल से एक वाली रखती है एक वली रखती है जमात अहमदिया का एक मौला है
और जमीन व आसमान का खुदा हमारा मौला है, लेकिन मैं तुम्हें बताता हूं कि तुम्हारा कोई मौला नहीं। खुदा की कसम, जब हमारा मौला हमारी मदद को आएगा तो कोई तुम्हारी मदद नहीं कर सकेगा। खुदा की तकदीर जब तुम्हें टुकड़े टुकड़े करेगी तो तुम्हारे नामो निशान मिटा दिए जाएंगे और हमेशा दुनिया तुम्हें जिल्लत और रुसवाई के साथ याद करेगी।
On the 17th of August, the C-130 Hercules transport plane carrying General Ziel-Huck was blown out of the sky. All 31 people on board died. The team investigating the crash eliminated one by one various possible reasons for the crash. How this had happened, the investigators were unable to say. Why it had happened, the whole world knew.
I had said in my opinion कि कल चली थी जो लेखू पे तेरे दुआ, आज भी इज्न होगा तो चल जाएगी। बस खुदा की कसम वो तेरे दुआ चल चुकी है, अब इसे काट कर दिखाओ, इसे रद्द करके दिखा दो, तब मैं मानूं।
The 23rd of March 1989 marked 100 years of the Ahmadiyya community. Grand ceremonies took place in almost 100 countries, with special programs held in the headquarters in London to celebrate this momentous day. From a humble beginning in Qadian to establishing communities in 120 countries, the last 100 years saw the community grow from strength to strength. 1991 was yet another special year for Ahmadis. They had just celebrated 100 years of the community's success through divine help. This year was going to mark 100 years since the start of the community's annual conference. Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi IV decided to attend the 100th annual conference himself.
India is fine. You know, I've been looking forward to visiting India for a long, long time now.
It was an emotional journey, as this was the first time since the partition he was going back to the town where the community had started. It was this very town where he was born and spent his childhood.
एक अपना भी तो घर था, जैसे सुंदर थी वो बस्ती, वैसा वो घर भी सुंदर था।
बड़े मजा आ रहे हैं आंधे ही, मैं और मेरे बच्चे इस तरह सी एक्साइट हो गए सी। मेरी बच्चियां पहली दफा आई ने, ते वो भी कहंदियां ने, कहंदे ने हुन सानू पता लगा तुसी केड़े मजे उड़ा बैठे हो। कहते आना खुद एक जिंदगी का मजा है, जो इतने की फिजा है दूसरे देखो ना, इतने जमात दे बानी पैदा हुए, उन्होंने हवा इस हवा भी साह लिते, इन्हें गलियां फिरे, उन्होंने मकान च असी रह रहे हाँ। यह जज्बाती ताल्लुक इन्ना गहरा है कि एक मजहबी आदमी ही इन्हू महसूस पूरी तरह कर सकता है, लेकिन यह सिर्फ मजहबी ताल्लुक नहीं, गहरा इंसानी रिश्ता है। और क्योंकि उन्होंने ताल्लुक सारे इर्द गिर्द इंसान हिंदू बाजार नाल है, उत्थे मलावा मल दे नाल उन्होंने तालुकात, होर सिखां दे नाल तालुकात, वो सारे ताल्लुक वाले उमट के पए ने, और हर एक दसदा है कि असी भी तुहाडे वाकफ वाले प्यारियां विचों हैं, तुहाडे वाकफां विचों हैं। सारा माहौल लगता है कि जिस तरह अपने मोहब्बत करने वालों का माहौल है, प्यार वालों का माहौल है, बड़े लुत्फ आ रहे हैं, बहुत खुशी हो रही है। कॉन्फ्रेंस साढ़े वास्ते बहुत ज़्यादा अहमियत रखती है, इस लिहाज नाल के 100 साल दे विच एक दफे ही आना है ना 100 साल का जलसा। लेकिन इस जलसे विच नाल यह गल शामिल हो गई कि जदों दी तकसीम हुई है, हिंद पार्टीशन हुई है, उदों बाद कोई खलीफा कदी इत्थे नहीं आया, और पहली दफा अल्लाह ताला ने मैनू हिम्मत दित्ती फैसला करन दी, तौफीक अता फरमाई।
Thousands of Ahmadis from all over the world converged upon Qadian. Huzoor addressed the annual conference.
Sab hazirin e jalsa ko aur un sab ko bhi jo is saeed bakht jalsa mein shamooliyat se mahroom rahe hain, main Hazrat Aqdas Masih Maud alaihi salatu wa salam ke ilham ki zuban mein mubarak 100 mubarak pesh karta hoon. आज का ये तारीखी जलसा कई लिहाज से मुनफरिद है और यकता है। ऐसा जलसा एक ही दफ़ा आना था और एक ही दफ़ा आया है। اللہ تعالیٰ کا بے انتہا احسان ہے کہ اس نے آج ہمیں اس میں شمولیت کی سعادت بخشی ہے.
Shortly after returning from Qadian, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV had to bear a great loss.
آج جمعہ کا مبارک دن ہے, 29 رمضان ہے, الوداعی جمعہ کہلاتا ہے, جمعۃ الوداع. اس جمعہ کے آغاز ہی میں, یعنی جب سورج ڈھل گیا جمعرات کا اور اسلامی نقطۂ نگاہ سے جمعہ کی رات شروع ہو گئی, اور جب انگریزی نقطۂ نگاہ سے بھی رات کے 12 بجے اور 1-2 منٹ اوپر ہوئے, اس وقت میری بیوی کو اپنے رب کا بلاوا آ گیا.
فاصلے بڑھ گئے پر قرب تو سارے ہیں وہی, نہ وہ تم بدلے نہ ہم, تار ہمارے
at that time was, of course, for him it was a very emotional moment, naturally for anyone in that situation. But the fortitude that he bore and how he bore this loss, both for his sake and for the sake of his family, it was quite, it was more emotionally rendering, I think, for the community at that time, because Hazur was very stoic in the face of this loss, and he bore it with great fortitude. And it was during, I think, again, it was visible to see at the namaz-e-janaza prayers of Hazrat Sayyida Asa Begum Sahiba.
Ye tere kaam hai Maula, mujhe de sabr o sabah.
I think around that time, perhaps it was Eid as well, and his other Jamaat commitments. I think for us, especially from a perspective of the Jamaat and those who are involved in the administration, for us it was again a lesson that as Allah wills, so be it, but the cause of the Jamaat, the furtherance of the Jamaat, doesn't really stop.
The 24th of March 1989 was a special day. It was the first Friday after the centenary of the community, and Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV delivered his sermon.
Aaj jo aap mere saath khutba juma pad rahe hain, khutba sun rahe hain ya juma pad rahe hain, aapko میں یہ اطلاع, خوشکن اطلاع بھی دیتا ہوں کہ اس وقت اس آواز کو موریشس کے احمدی بھی سن رہے ہیں اور جرمنی کے احمدی بھی سن رہے ہیں. یہ وہ صدی کا پہلا خطبہ ہے جس کو آسمانی رسل و رسائل کے ذریعے سے, جس کو سیٹلائٹ ہک اپ کہتے ہیں, سب سے پہلے موریشس کی جماعت نے سننے کا انتظام کیا, اور اب مجھے اطلاع ملی ہے کہ جرمنی کی جماعت نے بھی اس خطبے کو براہ راست سننے کا انتظام کیا ہوا ہے.
That further developed and it progressed into a way whereby 24 countries joined that group of countries who were listening to his Friday sermon through the telephone. In 1991, Huzoor graced the Jalsa Salana of Qadian Darul Aman. On that historic occasion, the addresses of Huzoor Rahimullah were relayed throughout the globe via satellite telephone link.
This laid foundations for a new form of communication, and reached a new height on the 31st of January 1992.
Aaj ka din Ahmadiyyat ki tareekh mein ek bahut hi mubarak din hai. Ye Juma Jamaat ki dusri sadi ki tareekh ke aagaaz mein ek bahut hi azim sang-e-meel nasab kar raha hai aur Jamaat ko jama hone ke ek naye daur mein dakhil kar raha hai. بنی نو انسان کی تاریخ میں پہلی مرتبہ حضرت مسیح موعود علیہ الصلوۃ والسلام کے اس عاجز غلام اور خلیفۃ المسیح کو یہ توفیق ملی ہے کہ ایسا خطبہ دے رہا ہے ایسا جمعہ پڑھا رہا ہے جو ایک بہت ہی طاقتور بر اعظم کے ایک کنارے سے دوسرے کنارے تک صوتی لحاظ سے بھی پہنچ رہا ہے اور تصویری لحاظ سے بھی پہنچ رہا ہے.
Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV's vision to lead the community to new heights manifested itself in the creation of a TV channel that would connect the community to their beloved leader. Initially, his Friday sermons were transmitted in Europe only, but on the 21st of August 1992, the transmission started spanning four continents. Through the blessings of this new medium, the barriers of distance were broken, and the community came together at the hand of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV at the annual conference in
1993. مختلف زبانوں میں ایک شخص کے ہاتھ پر بیعت کر رہے ہوں اور وہ شخص حضرت اقدس محمد مصطفیٰ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کے ایک غلام کا اتنا غلام ہو.
آج میں آپ سے عہد بیعت لیتا ہوں. ہاتھ بڑھائیے. اشہد اللہ الہ
الا اللہ. The international bat took place during the Jalsa. That event actually was telecast live throughout the globe. And that's how this concept of Hazur Rahmullah was actually materialized. And that was, I think, the milestone. That was the turning point from where Hazur wanted to progress forward, carry that momentum forward.
This momentum took MTA to a new level, and on the 7th of January 1994, MTA started its daily transmission from its Earth station in London.
Alhamdulillah, ke aaj woh juma ka din aaya jiski bahut der se dil mein tamanna thi aur ek muddat se intezar tha ke aaj khuda ke fazl ke saath international Ahmadiyya Muslim television ka باقاعدہ آغاز ہو رہا ہے. وہ جو جمعہ کا خطبہ پہلے ہر جمعے سنایا جاتا تھا وہ اگرچہ اسی ٹیلی ویژن کے ذریعے تھا لیکن ایک روزمرہ کی سروس کے طور پر ابھی یہ جاری نہیں ہوئی تھی. بس الحمدللہ کہ جس جو خوشخبری میں نے موریشس کی سرزمین سے دی تھی آج انگلستان کی سرزمین سے یہ اعلان کرنے کی توفیق مل رہی ہے کہ آج سے باقاعدہ مسلم ٹیلی ویژن احمدیہ کی روزانہ سروس کا آغاز ہو چکا ہے.
حضور رحم اللہ, آئی تھنک ہی آئی کوڈ آلویز فیل دیٹ وٹ ایور وی ٹاکڈ اباؤٹ ویدر اٹ واز اباؤٹ دا کمرشل سائڈ آف دا کانٹریکٹس دا سیٹلائٹ کانٹریکٹس ویری کمپلیکس سیٹلائٹ کانٹریکٹس whether it was about the technological aspects of the television, of the broadcast industry, of the satellite transmissions, I always found that he was one step ahead. I don't know how. To even this day, I don't know. But he was.
Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV maintained a deep interest in the administration and the overall supervision of MTA. Under his guidance, the channel progressed rapidly starting its 24-hour service across the globe on the 1st of April, 1996. He personally initiated new programs and participated in countless broadcasts, ranging from lectures, sermons, question and answer sessions, to teaching the Holy Quran and homeopathy. Catering for a variety of languages for young and old, he ensured that MTA sought to provide an education and training medium unrivaled in history. He used to love children and would sit among them and tell them stories and at the same time teach them some very important lessons in life. His charismatic personality graced the screens of millions. Suddenly the boundaries were shrunk and his message could reach them no matter where in the world they were.
جماعت احمدیہ کی عالمی برادری ایک خاندان بن گئی ہے ایک ہاتھ پر اکٹھے ہو کر ایسے اتحاد کا نظارہ کبھی پہلے کسی نے نہیں دیکھا تھا کیا ہاں جرمنی والے کہتے ہیں ہم بھی جرمنی تو یہاں بیٹھا ہوا اکثر ماشاء اللہ زمبابوے سے بھی سوچیں ذرا کہاں زمبابوے کہاں یہ دنیا اللہ کے فضل سے جاپان سے آ گیا ہے قادیاں والے بھی بول رہے ہیں کہ نہیں ابھی تک اچھا اللہ اکبر جماعت ہائے احمدیہ عرب زندہ باد جماعت احمدیہ عجمان و شارجہ زندہ باد گیمبیا سے بھی ماشاءاللہ دیکھیں کہاں کہاں سے آج عالمی رابطہ ہے اکٹھے بیٹھے ہوئے برادری کتنی عظیم ہے یہ کبھی دنیا میں ایسا واقعہ ہوا ہے کبھی ہوا ہے یہ واقعہ مسیح موت کی دعائیں ہیں جو عرش پر سنی گئی محمد مصطفیٰ کا اعجاز ہے جو آج ظاہر ہو رہا ہے
حضرت خلیفہ تلمسی IV was an internationally acclaimed thinker and scholar of comparative religion. He was a prolific writer and author of many scholarly works. In his books, he dealt with social, political, and moral issues facing the world. Some of his books include Murder in the Name of Allah, Gulf Crisis and the New World Order, Universal and Moral Values, Politics and World Peace, Islam's Response to Contemporary Issues, An Elementary Study of Islam, Christianity, A Journey from Facts to Fiction, Absolute Justice, Kindness and Kinship. His masterpiece was Revelation, Rationality, Knowledge and Truth. Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi IV was a great poet. His collection of Urdu poetry, Ghulam-e-Tahir, was also published during his lifetime. He had a profound understanding of religious scriptures. He delivered lectures and held classes to teach the meaning of the Holy Quran. For the benefit of mankind, he also translated the Holy Quran in a fluent, simple and easy to understand form. His question and answer sessions were a testament to his knowledge. He was asked all kinds of questions on all kinds of subjects. Whether it was science or religion, moral or social issues, he was never short of a reply.
Abba, mujhe yaad hai ye kaha karte the ki meri walida ki badi khwahish thi ki doctor bane mera beta aur gurba ka mufat ilaaj kare aur کہتے ہیں میں ڈاکٹر ایلوپیتھک ڈاکٹر تو نہیں بن سکا لیکن ہومیوپیتھک کی اللہ تعالیٰ نے توفیق دی اور اس میں یہ بھی ہوا کہ بہت بڑھ کے غربا کا بھی علاج کیا اپنے
His interest in homeopathy developed with an incident in his early 20s when he used to suffer from migraine.
مجھے ایک سردرد کی تکلیف ہوتی تھی جو میگرین کہلاتی ہے اس لیے پھر میں نے حضرت مسلم آؤت کی طرف جو کیا آپ کے پاس ایک دوائی تھی سینڈول جو کلکتے سے آیا کرتی تھی ایک دفعہ چھوٹی میرا پاکو میں نے لیٹا ہوا تھا کافی تکلیف تھی آنکھ کھولنی بھی مشکل تھی تو گرمیوں کی شام تھی میں نے کہا آپ ابا جان سے جا کے میرے لیے سینڈول لے آئیں تو کچھ دیر کے بعد واپس آئیں تو انہوں نے کہا کہ وہ سینڈول تو ختم ہو چکی ہے تو انہوں نے فرمایا ہے کہ میں ہومیوپیتھک دوائی دیتا ہوں یہ استعمال کر کے دیکھ لو اس وقت تک مجھے کوئی خاص یقین نہیں تھا ہومیوپیتھی پہ تبرکن میں نے کہا ٹھیک ہے وہ دوائی منہ میں میری پوڑیا منہ کھول دیا آنکھیں بند اسی طرح اور پوڑیا منہ میں ڈال دی میٹھی گولیوں کی اور کچھ دیر باتیں دو تین منٹ باتیں کی کہ میں جانے لگی ہوں کچھ فرق پڑا تو اچانک مجھے محسوس ہوا کہ درد ہے ہی نہیں یعنی ہونے اور نہ ہونے کے درمیان جو نو مینز لینڈ ہے وہ بھی نہیں تھی تو اس سے مجھے یقین ہو گیا کہ یہ کوئی جادو ٹون کا نہیں ہے نہ محض تبرک بلکہ اس میں کچھ حقیقت ہے کوئی خدا تعالیٰ نے نظام جاری فرمایا ہوا ہے پھر میں نے حضرت مسلم موعود کی لائبریری سے ہی وہاں بہت کتابیں تھیں بڑا ذخیرہ تھا جا کر وہاں صحت طبیعت پوچھنے جایا کرتے تھے ہم عام طور پر مغرب کے بعد جایا کرتے تھے طبیعت پوچھ کے پھر میں لائبریری میں چلا جاتا تھا پھر وہاں سے اٹھانی بھی شروع کر دیں اور گھر لے آتا تھا اور بعض وقت ساری ساری رات پڑھتا رہا تو بہت لمبا عرصہ میں نے شناسائی حاصل کی ہے اور ابھی علاج نہیں شروع کیا بلکہ کتابوں پر کتابیں پڑھیں ان کو دواؤں کے مزاج کو اپنے ذہن میں ان کا نقش جمایا پھر رفتہ رفتہ اس کی پریکٹس شروع کی
اور مجھے یاد ہے جب ابا نے شروع کی ہے ہومیوپیتھک تو ہم تو بہت چھوٹے چھوٹے تھے تو گھر میں ایک چھوٹی سی الماری ہوتی تھی پچھلے کمرے میں ادھر بیمار آ کے بیٹھتے تھے گاؤں سے مختلف جگہوں سے آ رہے ہوتے تھے اور کچھ جب زیادہ ہونا شروع ہو گیا تھا باہر بھی بیٹھا کرتے تھے پھر جب کافی زیادہ بڑھ گئے تو پھر ابا نے یہ پہلے تو پھپھی حکمی ابھی سندھ ہوا کرتی تھی میری پھپھی ان کے گھر لے گئے تھے پھر وہاں بھی جب نہیں سما سکے تو پھر اپنے وقفے جدید کے دفتر میں لے گئے تھے اور ادھر ابا کرتے رہتے
Despite his busy schedule after becoming Khalifa, he continued to practice homeopathy.
باوجود دیگر تمام مصروفیات کے روزانہ خطوط میں سینکڑوں لوگ مسلمان غیر مسلم احمدی غیر احمدی ان کے خطوط آتے تھے اپنی امراض کے لیے وہ علاج مانگتے تھے حضور کی طرف سے ان کی دوائیاں بتائی جاتی تھیں اور سفروں میں بھی حضور کا یہ طریق تھا کہ لوگ آتے تھے جس کو بھی پتہ چلتا کہ آپ ہومیوپیتھی کے ذریعے بھی علاج فرماتے ہیں ہندو سکھ عیسائی لا مذہب ہر قسم کے لوگ وہ آتے اور آپ سے ہومیوپیتھی جو ہے طریقہ علاج حاصل کرتے اور اس کے نتیجے میں شفا پاتے تھے
He took weekly classes to teach homeopathy and made every effort to make this form of treatment common. His lectures were compiled as a book and were published under the title Homeopathy, Like Cures Like. He was a great humanitarian. Welfare of the weak and underprivileged was always very close to his heart. Under his guidance, homeopathic clinics were established. In addition to the large numbers of hospitals and schools open to serve the poor in the most needy countries of the world, he also established an organization called Humanity First. The main purpose of this organization was to alleviate human suffering. Physicians, teachers, engineers, and professionals from all walks of life belonging to the community volunteered their time to help the deprived by providing basic medical and educational needs. Special envoys were sent in war-torn and disaster-struck countries to provide urgent medical help and relief.
If you believe in Creator, you must also believe in His creation. If you love the artist, you must also love his art. As such, our concept of Islam is so beautiful and so well poised that it has started attracting attention all over the world. People from the north, from the south, from the west, from the east, all over the world joining Ahmadiyyat at a greater speed, which is now turning into not a speed but acceleration. And if you go to Africa, if you go travel to Southeast Asia, small islands like Tuvalu, etc., everywhere you will find more number of people joining Ahmadiyyat and finding peace, finding a singleness of human character which is missing elsewhere.
She
The Ahmadiyya Muslim community is a truly global community. Under the dynamic leadership of Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi IV, the community continued to spread throughout the world. Right from the beginning of his Khilafat, he regularly traveled to European countries, including Germany, Holland, Belgium, France, Switzerland, Italy, Spain, Sweden, Denmark, Norway, and Portugal. His visits enhanced the missionary efforts and rejuvenated these communities. In the Far East, he toured Singapore, Fiji, Australia, Japan and Sri Lanka to meet members of the community and to make an appraisal of the opportunities for further progress. He took the message of peace to the people of Africa and toured Gambia, Sierra Leone, Liberia, the Ivory Coast, Ghana and Nigeria in 1988. This highly successful tour of six countries spanned over 5 weeks. During his tour, he met heads of state, ministers, parliamentarians, and paramount chiefs. The members of the community were overjoyed to meet the Khalifa. He breathed new life into the community, and many came into the fold of Ahmadiyyat. He continued the missionary efforts to Mauritius and East Africa, where he toured Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. The South American countries of Suriname, Trinidad and Tobago, Guatemala, and Guyana were also blessed with his visits. Community members in these countries had the opportunity of meeting with his exalted personage and benefiting from his sublime discourses. The Ahmadiyya communities all around the world hold annual conventions to bring the community together. Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi IV regularly graced and addressed these conventions during his visits. Among the many countries he regularly toured, the USA and Canada were fortunate to have their annual conventions blessed with his faith-inspiring addresses. During his visits, he also inaugurated new mosques in both Canada and the USA. After Huzoor's migration, he graced the annual conventions held in the United Kingdom, and due to the headquarters being moved to London, they became an international gathering. Among the other European communities, in particular, the annual conventions in Germany were frequently graced by his presence. In July 2000, Huzoor visited Indonesia, the largest Muslim country in the world. During the visit, Huzoor met the president of Indonesia. He also addressed the community's annual convention of Indonesia, which attracted a large crowd. All these tours by Huzoor strengthened and uplifted the spirituality and created awakening among the Ahmadi masses. Through his efforts, the community grew year after year. More and more people joined the fold of Ahmadiyyat, and many new missions were established throughout the world.
شخصیت کے بہت سے پہلو تھے اور ہر پہلو ہی حسین تھا آپ کا علم و فضل آپ کی خوش مزاجی خوش اخلاقی ہمدردی الفاظ میں تو اس کو سمیٹا نہیں جا سکتا
ابا کی محبت بھی اور تعلق بھی اور دوستی بھی غربا سے بھی تھی عمرا سے بھی تھی بچوں سے بھی تھی بڑوں سے بھی تھی بوڑھوں سے بھی تھی اور جاہلوں سے بھی تھی اور ان سے ان پڑھ لوگوں سے بھی ہے بہت علم فاضل لوگوں سے بھی مجھے لگتا ہے ابا کو کبھی بھی کسی سے محبت کرنے میں کوشش نہیں کرنی پڑی یہ فطرت تھی اور فطرت تھی اور اس کا اظہار بھی بہت کھل کے کیا کرتے تھے اس لیے وہ لوگوں کو اٹیک بھی زیادہ کرتا تھا کیونکہ جو آپ کے دل سے ابھر رہی ہو چیز وہ ظاہر ہے زیادہ اٹیک کرتی ہے
غیر ان کی اس لیے وہ زیادہ پیار کرتے تھے کیونکہ اس یہ ٹور سے آئے ہیں ان کی تربیت کرنا ہے ہاں جی ان کو سمجھ آنا ہے اس لیے بہت پیار کرتے تھے اگر میں سمجھ جاتا ہوں وہ میرے ساتھ اچھا پیار کرتے ہیں حالانکہ صرف میرے ساتھ پیار نہیں کرتے پر لیکن سارے غیر ملک سے پیار کرتے ہیں
حضور لوڈ چلڈرن گریٹلی ہی وڈ ایون اسٹاپ فار دیم پک دیم اپ کڈل دیم give them sweets, make them feel as if they were Huzoor's own children.
There was some spontaneity in him that sort of made you feel alive and cared for. And he was quite strong on what was right and what was proper, what was Islamic and what was not. And, you know, there was no duplicity in him.
और वे पहचान भी जाते थे बहुत जल्दी पहचान लेते थे कि कोई झूठ बोल रहा है।
He was able to read a mind of a person like anything. It was surprising.
Well, he was just a complete man in himself. I think anyone who came into contact with him just thought that he had him for that period of time, as if he was just for his whole being was just for this one individual. And I think that was his greatest characteristic. He was so complete, that so perfect in many respects. It was his knowledge, it was his sheer enthusiasm, but also that in his personal life he was so complete as well. We mentioned his fondness for sport, his fondness for writing, and again from cooking to photography to hiking to walking to cycling. He just embodied everything that perhaps a perfect man can be, and I think that's the best memory I have of him, and something that we all perhaps can strive to, into how we can balance our lives ultimately to achieve success, and also to balance both the spiritual side and the personal side of one's life.
He spent his life in the service of humanity. The very first scheme of his Khilafat was set up to provide housing for the needy. And on the 21st of February 2003, he launched Maryam Shadi Fund, which was devoted to providing financial help for the marriage of girls in the poorest areas. Just 2 months had passed after the initiation of the Maryam Shadi Fund. On the 19th of April 2003, Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi IV passed away at the age of 74.
मेरे दर्द की जो दवा करे।
Thousands of people came to pay their last respects. His funeral prayer was led by Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, the fifth successor to the promised Messiah. His sacred remains were reverently committed to the earth on the 23rd of April at Islamabad, Tilford. Hazrat Khalifa Tulmasi IV's leadership was characterized by vibrancy and dynamism that became the hallmark of his 21-year tenure of office. He spread the message of God. He was a fountain of knowledge. He touched the hearts of people. He was loved by young and old. He was a man of dignity, a man of peace. He was a man of God.
हुआ करे वो जो बेपनाह उदास हो मगर हिज्र का न गिला करे मेरे दर्द की जो दवा करे कोई ऐसा शख्स हुआ करे वो जो बेपनाह उदास हो मगर हिज्र का न गिला करे मगर हिज्र का न गिला करे कोई ऐसा शख्स हुआ करे कोई ऐसा शख्स हुआ करे